Hi everybody, welcome to the next lecture on multirate signal processing, lecture 2 on multiresolution. So last time we saw that using filter banks we get a time frequency resolution, or a time frequency representation. So that means we have a certain number of subbands, each subband represents a frequency, and then the subbands are downsampled, and each sample represents a time point, even though at a lower sampling rate. So this can be seen here in this plot or in this diagram. So we see on the horizontal axis, we see time. So each line here basically represents a sampling point at the lower sampling rate. So here, these are the sampling intervals of the filter bank. So that's the same for all the subbands. And vertically, you can see the frequency axis. And that means that each line here horizontally represents one subband of our input. So here, lowest subband and then going up, and here is the highest subband. So that means that each tile here represents one frequency vertically and one time instance, one time point horizontally. So basically we turned our one-dimensional audio signal, for instance, into a two-dimensional representation, which also has frequency. So now it has frequency and time at a reduced resolution. And it's in such a way that if you have critical sampled filter banks, the total number of samples stays the same. So if we have, for instance, 1024 subbands, then we downsample by a factor of 1024 along the time axis, and that means the total number of samples stays the same. So we just created a two-dimensional representation out of our original one-dimensional one. Yeah, so this is also called a spectrogram. It shows the amount of signal energy in each of those time frequency bins or rectangles here. So they're also called tiles. In Python, a spectrogram is produced with the command specgram in the pyplot library. An example for an audio signal, for instance, we call it top chart here. That's our sample. We can generate with this code. So for instance, we can do it in IPython PyLab, but you can also do it in just normal Python and write a program, for instance, or just type it in your terminal. So this is now the terminal version. We use IPython minus PyLab. First, we import scipy.io wave file to read our sound from a wave file. So here, this WAV file. We abbreviate it as WAV. And then here in the next line, you can see the object WAV contains the function read, which is now able to read a WAV file. This is our local sound file that we use for this experiment. And it returns the sound samples in this array SND. So if the sound was stereo, then we have a two-dimensional array. If it is mono, as in this case, we have a one-dimensional array. And rate contains the sampling rate, which comes from this file. So here we can see the size of SND. We have 300,000 samples. We could do something similar using our sound library. So the sound library is in Moodle 2, so you can download it. It contains also functions for real-time access to microphone and speaker, so that's convenient. And using the sound library, you could read this file, or in this case here, you can actually record it yourself. So sound library contains the function record, and this records for 5 seconds with the sampling rate FS, and FS is set to 32,000, and it's one channel, mono. So in case you don't have a sound file or you want to record your own sound, you can just talk into the microphone of your computer for 5 seconds and then you will have a sound a file or a sound inside your sound array SND. So then you can analyze the sound in SND using spectrum. So here you can see how it works. So spectrum comes from the library pyplot in this case, and you would just give it the argument SND. This is the sound that you want to analyze, and then NFFT is the size of the FFT filter bank it uses to analyze it. And FS is our sampling frequency. So in this case, we have a normalized frequency, and that means the sampling frequency is normalized to being 2, which means the Nyquist frequency is now 1. So very convenient. So here we can now see horizontally the time in FFT blocks. So this is the sample number of our downsampled signal at the output of our FFT filter bank. And here vertically, you can see the numbering of, or the labeling of our subbands going from 0 to 1, where 1 is our Nyquist frequency. So we know we have 32,000 samples per second sampling rate. So that means our Nyquist frequency is 16 kilohertz. So then 1.0 corresponds to 16 kilohertz. And here you can see, there's the fundamental frequency down here, and then you have harmonics. So this looks like a voice, right? So here you have the fundamental, it changes slightly, and then you have the harmonics, which are multiples of it. And so this looks like a singing voice, and on top of it here, it looks like there is a more tonal instrument. So typical spectrogram for music with singing voice. Yeah, so we can also try it using our terminal shell. So here's the terminal. I'm starting with IPython minus PyLab. So now it starts. Actually, just before that, I tried IPython 3, but for some reason, I'm getting an error message from IPython 3. There seemed to be an installation problem. But IPython is still working. So I have now IPython. I started it with PyLab. Let's see. Where do we see it? Too many messages. Okay. So this should be working. We have this colorful prompt here. And that shows us we are in IPython now. And now we can just copy and paste this first import line here, Control C, then paste it here. So now I'm importing scipy.io WAF file, and now I'm reading my WAF read. Okay, so I'm reading the file, paste. Yes. So that worked because this file is locally present in my current directory. And then we can see the size of SND. So here we see 330,000 samples. So that means 10 seconds. We can also say SND.shape. Basically gives us the same information and it shows us that we have a one-dimensional array. So now we can try spectrum, this line here, copy and paste, let it run, and indeed we get our nice spectrogram. Here you can see it. And you can see now we have 160,000 samples here, which means that we have a downsampling factor of only 2. For the spectrum, which means in this case the FFT is not used as a critical sampled filter bank but as a oversampled filter bank. So we have many more samples than we would need for reconstruction. but it's good for representation of all the frequencies at a higher time resolution. Okay, so we can close this again. Yeah, so the color that we see in this plot indicates the signal energy or magnitude of the coefficient of the underlying FFT bin at a given time and frequency. So basically, we have a we would need three dimensions, right? We have time, we have frequency, and we have intensity at that time and frequency. So that's why we take color as the third dimension to indicate the intensity or the level in this in each time frequency bin. And blue means we have a low magnitude of the FFT coefficients, and red means we have high magnitudes of the FFT coefficients. Right? So going back here, we can see in this region here we have very low magnitudes, which means very low energy. But here in the region where we have red, we have high energy or high magnitudes. Right. So now we can also listen to the signal that we just imported. And for that, again, we use our library sound, which you can download from Moodle 2, because it has our function sound, which basically just plays back our sound array at this sampling rate so that we can listen to what it sounded like. So let me try it from sound. So now we imported just this function. So this is the library, and from the library sound, we import the function sound. So we don't import everything, but just this function. And now we can play it back using this function sound. Let's see if that works.
You're all I ever wanted.
Yes, so that worked. So here you could hear down now that it indeed is a singing voice and instruments, accompanying instruments, as you already guessed from looking at the spectrogram. Yeah, so the size of the time frequency bins of the FFT is independent of time or frequency. So they have the same shape no matter at what frequency you look or at what time you look. The duration is the same, and also the bandwidth is the same for each subband. So that's also why it's called a uniform filter bank. It's uniform over frequency and also over time. Yeah, and now I have a real-time Python example. So this is a function that I wrote. We can actually take a look inside. So we can open it. This is also in Moodle 2. First, I need to close my IPython interactive mode. And now we can say gedit pyrexpec waterfall. So here you can see the file. And you can see it defines the sampling rate as 48,000 hertz. So it's now higher than the example that we just saw. It has a block size, which we call chunk, of 2048 samples. It uses 2 bytes per sample. This is the standard for audio, basically. And it uses one channel, which means mono. We could also say two. And it uses Pi Audio as the audio interface. Pi Audio can access the sound card for microphone and speaker. Struct is for converting to and from the byte representation of the sound card. Yeah, NumPy is for math functions, and CV2 I'm using for live display of my spectrogram. So now here you can see what it's doing. It accesses the sound card using Pi Audio. So P is now the pointer to the sound card. And here it just displays the devices that it found. Here first the device count, and then it displays the ability of each sound card. So this is just for information to see what capabilities your computer has. And then it opens a stream to the sound card. So here it says, basically it gives the sound card the information. Here the width, which means 2 bytes per sample. Here the channels, which was mono. Here is the rate, which was the 48,000 samples per second. Input is true, which means we access the sound card microphone. Output is also true, which means we can also play back sound. And frames per buffer, this is the number of samples that it reads at once. So here the 2048 samples. Yeah, and then it sets up our waterfall, which is actually now moving. So we will have the spectrogram moving such that the newest time will appear at the bottom. And actually such that, yeah, as before we have horizontally, we now have the frequency, and vertically we will have the time. So the newest time will also always appear at the bottom. So we will have 500 rows in our spectrogram. So this corresponds to the time points. Then we will have 512 columns. This corresponds to our subbands. And here I'm fixing the FFT length, which is columns times 2. And this is because the FFT computes positive and negative frequencies. So if we just want to have 512 positive frequencies, that means the FFT also computes 512 negative frequencies, and that's why we need to have this factor of 2. Here I initialize our spectrogram with all zeros. And then I have this infinite loop here. And in this loop, in the beginning, it reads a new block of samples, 2048 samples. Then here it converts those 2-byte samples first into short integers and then into float numbers. Samples now contains an array of floats, 2048 floats. And here it then displays. So here I can actually set the update rate of the display. So here it displays for each time it runs through this loop. But if you set it to 2 or 4, then it would only update the display every second or fourth time it runs through this loop. And this is suitable for slow computers. Yeah, so here it shifts up the previous rows. So all the rows are shifted one up so that the lowest one becomes available for the new spectrum. And here is now the new spectrum. So here we get the samples. I'm taking a block of size FFT length. So you notice actually FFT length is shorter than the chunk size. This is again for slow computers. This speeds up processing. Yeah, and then it takes the lower half of it because we only need the positive frequencies. Here we have some normalization. We take the magnitude because this is all we can display in our display. We make sure that the magnitude does not become 0 by adding a 1 here, because then we want to apply a logarithm to get something like a dB representation. And here I'm dividing by log 10 to make this a log of base 10, which we wouldn't really need here, but this makes it similar to a dB scale. And then we have a factor, a normalization factor of 0.25 here. And this becomes then the red channel of our color display. So I'm starting assigning the red to the lowest row here at primary color index 2, which is red. Then I'm generating green, the green primary color component, as magnitude of 1 minus 2r. So this is basically just a nonlinear function which gives me different colors for different magnitudes. And finally the blue one here with the index 0 as 1 minus r. So this gives me different colors for different magnitudes. So if r is really small, then blue is large. That means we get a bluish tone. If R is large, then blue disappears, which means we get a reddish tone, basically as before. Yeah, and then we display the resulting frame with imshow, and then we ask the key what key was pressed, and if the key Q was pressed, then it basically leaves this infinite loop and destroys all windows and stops our stream. So yeah, that's basically all what's happening. So it takes the FFT of each block and displays it in those colors at the lowest row of our display and shifts everything else one up. So now we can actually try it out. So remember, it now accesses the microphone. So now it captures my sound. So I say Python 3 and let it run. So here you go. So here you can now see my live spectrogram. And now you can see here my speech. On the horizontal axis, you have frequency. On the right-hand side, you have the Nyquist frequency. So since we have 48 kilohertz sampling, this would be 24 kilohertz. So quite high, actually. And then you see everything is moving up. And that means the newest time is down and the older time goes up. And you can also see here the yellow tones mean high energy, and when you go to the blue tones, it means low energy. So as before, the most energy you can find at the low frequencies, and towards the high frequencies, it tapers off. So you can actually see the structure of speech. So let me say a few vowels. So you can see, you can clearly distinguish the different vowels in its shape in the spectrogram. And this is also why this spectrogram is used to analyze speech. Furthermore, this representation is used for instance, for speech recognition, because each sound has a unique spectral fingerprint here in this type of spectrogram. And you can also see that right is higher frequencies when I whistle. So when I whistle, it's basically a tone which comes more or less close to a sinusoid, which means the single frequency. So that should appear as a line. So let me try. So here you can see those lines. You can see each tone is a line, and you see here where it's yellow, we have high power, and in the neighboring, in the vicinity, we have low power. So basically the sinusoid appears as more or less as a line. And the more to the right, the higher the frequency. So I can also change the frequency. So here you can see the tone goes up and down. So up means right and down means left. Yeah, so this is a nice representation to analyze sound, speech and music. Yeah, so that's also why it's often used for analyzing audio. So let me quit it by pressing Q. So now it's done. So remember hit Q, because it doesn't react to the cross that you usually have. It only reacts to the key Q, because that's how I programmed it. Right, and again, you find this program in Moodle for our course. So you should also try it on your own, using your own voice and your own computer to see if it runs on your computer, because this contains all the essential functionality that we will need. So make it work. Okay. Yeah, so we have time on the vertical axis and frequency on the horizontal axis. Yeah, and then we can also try out what happens if we do sampling, right? So this this spectrogram is nicely suited to see what happens if we violate Shannon Nyquist theorem, right? So here I wrote a script or a program which allows me to do downsampling with and without filtering. So let me first open it again. So this now goes back to multirate, right? Multirate means we do downsampling and upsampling, and now we can actually easily see live what happens if we do downsampling and upsampling. So here the beginning is the same, right? So then I'm printing a little information here. Then the setup here is the same as before. This is now different. Basically, I'm printing information on how to use the program on our live spec program screen. So this actually appears on the still empty part of the spectrogram screen before we have any content. So this will shift it up. So this will be gone. So here now I have a functionality which I access with keys. So wait key can be used to also query other keys, like the key S. S is for sampling. So each time I hit the key S, it turns on and off sampling. Right. So sampling here means it's first downsampling and then it's upsampling, so that the spectrogram always uses the same sampling rate, but in between it was downsampled. Then we can use the key F to toggle a low pass filter, and we apply this low pass filter before and after sampling. So we apply this low pass filter to avoid aliasing components before we downsample, and then we apply the same low pass filtering after we upsample it again to remove alias components. Yeah, and the key Q is still there for quitting, and we set the sampling frequency to the same. So let me see, what do we have here? Sampling frequency. The sampling frequency now here is 32 kilohertz. So this is now somewhat lower than before. So it's no longer 48, but now it's 32 kilohertz. Yeah, and the downsampling rate is capital N, which we can also set. Let me see, what did we set it? Here, capital N is equal to 8. So using the key S, we can downsample from 32 kilohertz to 1/8 of it, which is then, let me think, 4 kilohertz, right? Yeah, so 4 times 8, 2 times 8 is 16, 4 times 8 is 32 kilohertz. So activating the sampling basically reduces the sampling rate from 32 kilohertz to 4 kilohertz, and 4 kilohertz sampling rate means we have a Nyquist frequency of only 2 kilohertz, so quite low. So that's barely enough for speech to be understandable. And I did this kind of extreme downsampling because it makes the effect more easily visible and audible. Yeah, so then here I'm doing basically the same as before, except that I here have my flags. So here, filter on, this is the filter on flag. So if this flag is true, then we do the low pass filtering. And we see the coefficients for this filter are B and A. And I computed the B and A here with SciPy signal IIR filter. And I use this IIR filter because that allows me to get by with only a few coefficients. Here, 4 coefficients for each B and A, and still get a fairly efficient low pass filter. And you can see I have a cutoff frequency of 1900 hertz. And this is normalized to 16,000 hertz Nyquist frequency before we do the downsampling. So this prepares for the downsampling. So at this point, we have 32 kilohertz sampling rate, which means 16,000 hertz Nyquist frequency, and this is the normalization that IIR filter expect by default. So here, this is the cutoff frequency normalized to the Nyquist frequency at the original sampling rate. Here is the desired stop band attenuation, 60 dB, and here is the filter type, a low pass. So I tried out a few configurations and it turns out 4 coefficients gives me an okay filter. It's not great, but it's still okay, at least for the example here. And I don't want to take too many coefficients because more coefficients means more computation complexity, and again that might be a problem when you have a slow computer. So this is good for slow computers. Yeah, so if we have filter on, we do the filtering here. And here we do the sampling if our flag for sampling is on. Also here, if downsample on is true, then we do the sampling. And we do that by just having a pointwise, sample-wise multiplication with S. And S basically contains zeros, except at places where we have the index multiples, integer multiples of n. So here basically this percent capital N is a modulus computation. So this is always true if the index is integer multiples of n, and it's false and anytime else. So here I have a equality query. So this equality is true if there's no remainder. So every nth, every capital nth, we will have a true, and this true is interpreted as a 1 in Python. So this is kind of tricky, but it works. So this is basically our unit pulse train that we have here in S. So we multiply our samples with this unit pulse train, which has a 1 at every 8th position. So then samples here contains only 8th sample. Yeah, and we keep the zeros in it because we want to do the upsampling following it anyway. So this is basically downsampling and upsampling in one step. And then after upsampling, we also need the filtering. So if we apply this filter, we again, if we have, if this flag is true, then we apply this low pass filter again, as you can see here. So we have samples is now the filtered version, and we have the Z is the internal memory of our filter. So the same here for the case before downsampling, we have this ZD, which is the internal memory of the filter, and we need to basically keep it because we want to go the filter across the block boundary without artifacts. Right, and that's why we need to input the previous memory of the filter and output the current one for the next block. Same here for upsampling. So this is what you have to observe to absorb. You have to do to avoid artifacts across block boundaries. Yeah. So finally, in order to avoid clipping from filtering, or overloading the sound card, you have to do the clipping here to basically limit the range of your samples to -32,000 to +32,000, because this is all you can represent with 16-bit signed integers. So here you then convert it to signed integers, and here you convert it to 2-byte integers, which you can then write to the sound card, so you can actually hear yourself back. And this also means you can hear the alias artifacts, which is also interesting. So you can not only see the alias artifacts in your spectrogram, but you can also hear how they sound at the output of your speaker. And that sometimes is a little bit tricky, because if your speaker is too loud, you get feedback and you get a beeping noise. Yeah, so finally, after upsampling, you see the spectrogram display as before. So nothing changed at this part here. And then it displays it on your screen until you hit the key Q. And here you have the wait key. And the wait key not only queries the key Q, but also, as mentioned, the key F for filtering and the key S for sampling. Okay, so now we understand what's going on and we can actually execute it. So here I'm using Python 3. Let's see. Yes, and this is what I warned you about. There's too much sound, so I need to reduce my volume. Let's see, I'm using ISO mixer. So this can be conveniently used. ISO mixer, you can see the output. Let me reduce this a little bit more here. And let's see if this works better now.
Test.
Okay, still a little bit much. Let me reduce it a little bit more. Yeah, so in the beginning, sampling is off and filtering is off. So what you see then is basically what we saw before. And maybe I can quickly press key F for filtering, because then there's not that much from the signal left. So it becomes softer at the same time, because only the low frequency energy is left. So let me try. So now filtering is true. And what you can see now is the low-pass version. So the high frequency range is missing. And I still get some feedback and some hearing. So maybe I can reduce the volume even more. So that's something you also have to try on your system.
So now there's less volume, and indeed we get less feedback. And now I'm turning on F. Filtering. So now this is more low-pass. As you can also see in the spectrum. Originally it was going up all the way here. Right, there's orange and reddish colors here, so that means there's more energy in the high frequencies. And turning on the filter. Now you see it's mostly blue, that means at the high frequencies there's hardly anything left. Yeah, and here you can see the description. Basically like Star Wars, the description has shifted away, so I have to be careful to read it first. And now I can also turn on S for sampling. So I hit key S. So now sampling is true. So now it only keeps every 8th sample, downsampling rate of 8. So now it's actually quite soft, and that's because only every 8th sample is left. And that means we only have much less energy. So now I can turn off the filter off to see and hear what happens to the aliasing. So now the filter is false. And now you can see here, indeed, we get the alias components. And you can also hear maybe those chirpy noises. And this is what these alias components sound like. They basically make those chirpy noises. And when you look at the spectrum, it's basically this piece of the spectrum shifted up here. So it appears here, and it appears here again, and so on. And it's also mirrored. So you can see here, this part is the mirror of this first part. And this is because the spectrum also has negative frequency. So it actually extends to the left. And to the left you have the negative frequencies, which are basically mirrored version of the positive frequencies. So we basically shift everything from zero, positive and negative, to this point. So here this first line is originally zero, and now we can see here positive frequencies and here are negative frequencies. And it's repeated. So basically we have multiple alias components. So this represents the new sampling rate at a lower sampling rate. So this is basically frequency 4 kilohertz. This is 8 kilohertz. This is 12 kilohertz. And this is 16 kilohertz. Right. So basically, at the place of our new sampling rate, we will have a shifted version of our spectrum. And also at the harmonics of
this new sampling rate. We have the same thing. And this makes it sound so terrible. So if I would turn up the volume, you would hear it sounds very distorted with those chirpy voices. So, turning off sampling,
we have the original again. Like no filtering, no sampling. So now I have a good voice.
Sampling on, we have those chirpy noises. And filtering on removes those chirpy noises. And this shows why it's important to do the low-pass filtering. Low-pass filtering before downsampling and after. Before downsampling and after upsampling. Right? You can still see some rest here of this first Elis component. So the filter is not really so good. This is what you could actually also hear when you listen carefully with maybe with headphones. So our filter is not so great. Right, but then it's a cheap filter, right? It only has four coefficients for A and B. So what can you expect? So here it's doing a good job at the higher components, at the higher frequencies, but here the first Elis component, there is still enough left to be audible. Right, so it's not a perfect filter, but it's doing some job. So let me quit using Q. Yeah, so this gives you an impression about what can happen, what can go wrong with sampling, and also how to avoid those Elis artifacts. Yeah, so you can hear high-pitched artifacts in the voice, and this is the aliasing or the spectral copies. Yeah, so you can see these alias components as spectral copies of the original signal into higher frequencies. And also we can see that we can reduce those alias components using the low-pass filter. Then the higher spectral copies are attenuated and we hear fewer artifacts. Yeah, in this example we lost the upper 14 kHz of our signal, so most of it actually. And to avoid this, we can use filter banks, right, which not only use low pass, but also band pass filters and a high pass. So basically, they cover the entire frequency range. Yeah, and then there's also an alternative to the uniform frequency decomposition, which we saw so far, which is non-uniform frequency decompositions. An example is the so-called discrete wavelet transform, or DWT, which is the discrete time version of wavelets, which is basically a two-band decomposition after each low-pass filter. So here you can see it. We start with a two-band decomposition. Here is the audio signal. Now we have a low-pass again, followed by downsampling of a factor of 2. So remember, we just had a factor of 8. Here it's just 2, so much less. And we also have a high pass filter, also followed by a downsampling factor of 2. And we can do that because the high pass filter only gives us the half bandwidth. Same for the low pass. So the low pass and the high pass each only have half of the bandwidth of the original signal, and that's why we can downsample by this factor of 2. Still keeping the total number of samples the same. And then basically we can say for the low pass frequency range, which usually contains the most interesting part of the spectrum, we can apply the same again. So we can now basically have a finer frequency resolution by again applying a low pass and a high pass. Right? So now each of these output band passes have 1/4 of the bandwidth of the original audio signal, again followed by downsamplers of 2, and so on. So basically each time we assume that the low pass branch contains the most energy and the most interesting part of the spectrum, and then we increase the frequency resolution or reduce the bandwidth of the corresponding subbands. Yeah, and we can also draw a diagram for this, a time frequency diagram. So again, horizontally is the time, vertically is the frequency, And now we can see when we go to higher frequencies, we get wider bandwidth. So here we start with the lowest two subbands. So next time it's doubled. Here it should be doubled as well. It doesn't really fit quite as well in this diagram. It's not drawn to scale. And then there's another doubling here. And the same for the sampling in time. So here we have half of the original sampling rate. Then here's 1/4 of the original sampling rate. Next should be 1/8. So again, this is not really drawn according to scale, but it shows the principle. So we have a non-uniform decomposition. Okay, so this leads me to notations, frequency domain and notation. So in my formulas, I'm using colon equal to mean as, to mean defined as. For instance, A colon B, A colon equal B means A is defined as B. So that means you don't need to look, search for A because this is the first time it appears. And we will use letters like lowercase t, uppercase t, lowercase f for continuous values like time and frequency, and nmkl for discrete values, so after we do the sampling or after our applying an analog to digital converter. And we will use lowercase letters for time domain signals like x, lowercase x of n, and uppercase letters for transform domain signals like uppercase x of omega or uppercase x of z, right? Where omega and z would be frequency domain arguments. We will use boldface letters to denote vectors or matrices in both time domain and transform domain like capital lowercase x of m or capital uppercase, capital boldface z. So when it's a boldface, it's basically vectors or matrices. Yeah, and the conjugate complex operation is symbolized with a superscript asterisk like x star of n. So this is conjugate complex. And for transform domain signals like x of z, the asterisk x star of z denotes the conjugate complex operation of the coefficients only and not the argument z, because if it's a z transform, z can also be complex valued, so that makes a difference. But the overline x of z overline denotes the conjugate complex operation of the final result, meaning including the argument z. Right, so this is the distinction. Then capital E of X is the expectation of X of N. For our purposes, it's the average of X of N. So expectation is the statistical notation, basically it means average over all path possible of X. But in our case, we just average over the time. So we neglect other instances of X, just for the sake of practicality. Down arrow N symbolizes downsampling by a factor of capital N. If X of N is the signal we downsample, then we also write the downsample signal as X down arrow N. Then we have this N naught here of M. And this is defined as x of m times capital N plus n naught. So here you can see m is our new index at the lower sampling rate, and capital N is our downsampling factor. So basically here we jump to every nth sample with an offset of n naught. So here we are not necessarily starting at zero with a sampling, but we are starting at sample n naught. So basically n naught is the index of the first sample we keep in the downsampling, and we call this also the phase. And hence this phase n naught must be between 0 and n minus 1, capital N minus 1. right? So because this is the first sample. Yeah, and then up arrow capital N symbolizes upsampling by a factor of capital N, including insertion of the zeros. So if Y of M is the signal we upsample, then we also write the upsample signal as Y up arrow N with a phase N naught of N, lowercase n is now the higher sampling rate, and this is Y of M at the lower sampling rate if we are on the sampling grid, or zero if it's between the sampling grid. Right? Basically, we have our samples, we keep our samples if they are on the sampling grid, and we fill the in between the gaps in between we fill with zeros. And again, n naught is the index of the first non-zero sample in the upsample signal with a phase. So we also call it the phase, and this phase again is between 0 and capital N minus 1. Yeah, and then we have different types of frequency transforms. You should be more or less already familiar with them. First is the so-called discrete time Fourier transform, and this is discrete time. Our signal is sampled with sampling interval T, capital T, hence our samples only exist at the sampling time points, lowercase t equals n times capital T, the sampling interval, and n is an integer. So we can also rewrite this as lowercase t equals n divided by the sampling frequency, and the sampling frequency is simply defined as 1 divided by the sampling interval. So with an infinite signal length in time, we get the forward DTFT. We can actually derive it. So here you can see we apply the DTFT to our signal x of n. And here we have our DTFT kernel e to the minus j 2 pi f divided by fs times n. So this is basically very similar to the Fourier transform, where we would have 2 pi f, but here we normalize it to fs because we have this integer index here. So here you can see this, we have this n divided by fs, which is here corresponding to the time at the analog version of the signal. So that's why we have this n divided by fs here. So if we now keep the fs with the first part, 2 pi f divided by fs, we basically have a new frequency variable, which we call omega. Right? This omega here is 2 pi f divided by fs. And this is the normalized angular frequency. Right? And this normalization basically comes from sampling. So here, 2 pi f divided by fs. So here we normalize our frequency to the sampling frequency. So that also means if omega is 2 pi, then we are at the sampling frequency. So in this normalization, omega equals 2 pi means the sampling frequency, and hence omega equals pi means the Nyquist frequency. Yeah, the properties are this is continuous in frequency, right? Here this omega is continuous. We can basically use any value, any continuous value we want, as long as it's between 0 and 2 pi or minus pi to plus pi. And it's periodic. It repeats with the period 2 pi, which you can see here from e to the minus j omega n. So in e is 2 pi periodic, and that means it also becomes 2 pi periodic in omega. Yeah, and it's continuous in frequency because it is not periodic in time in general. And it's 2 pi periodic in frequency. So if we would also have a period in time, then we would have a fundamental frequency from this period and harmonics, and then it would become discrete in frequency. Yeah, so here you can see the periodicity. So e to the j omega basically is defined as cosine omega plus j sine of omega. And hence, e to the j omega plus 2 pi is a to e to the j omega. And that means for n larger than 1, we have a 2 pi periodicity, even a 2 pi divided by n periodicity, which in the sum adds up to a 2 pi periodicity. So basically for any n starting at n equals 1, we get this 2 pi periodicity, and for n equals 0, we have a constant. So you could also view this as a periodicity. Yeah. So if omega equals 2 pi, then we have f equals 2 fs, and that's the sampling frequency. And for omega equals pi, then we have the Nyquist frequency. Yeah, so if one domain is discrete, like in this case, time, the other domain is periodic, in this case, frequency. We could also do it the other way around. If we have a periodic time, that means we have a discrete frequency domain because we have a fundamental frequency and harmonics. Yeah, so we also have an inverse discrete time Fourier transform defined as this. So basically also very similar to the Fourier transform, except that now we only need to go over one period of the frequency domain from minus pi to pi. So this is not going from minus infinity to plus infinity, but just from minus pi to pi. And here you can see instead of a minus, we now have a plus here in the exponent of e. So easy enough. And also, just like in the Fourier transform, a convolution in time becomes a multiplication in the DTFT domain. So if you convolve two time discrete sequences to audio signals or an audio signal and a filter impulse response, then we multiply their corresponding DTFTs in the frequency domain. Yeah, remember convolution is defined as this convolution sum. So here we see the convolution sum. M is the index and it goes up in the first part of these sequences, and this m goes down for the second sequence. So for instance, h could be our filter impulse response, x is our audio signal, then this convolution sum would go up in the audio signal index, and it would go down on the impulse response index. So basically, effectively, it flips this impulse response. So this is mathematically more complicated than a simple multiplication in the transform domain. So that's also why it's advantageous to go to the transform domain. Yeah, then we have the discrete Fourier transform. So not the discrete time, but just the discrete Fourier transform, DFT. This is time discrete and finite in time. So that's the distinction between DTFT and DFT. The DFT assumes that we only have a finite length signal, which is in fact much more realistic, right? Because who has an infinitely long time domain signal, right? Never happens. So here we assume we have a signal of length n samples, and to make it mathematically more attractive, we assume that beyond this, the block goes on, or the signal goes on, with just the periodic continuation. So in this sense, we make it infinite again. So instead of just assuming we have this finite block of n samples, we assume that we have a continuation by just repeating this block infinitely many times, and then we can again apply the DTFT. So we can imagine the DFT as a DTFT applied to an infinite repetition of this finite length signal. And mathematically, indeed, this is what we then get, right? By applying the DTFT by this infinite repetition, we get then this formula as a transform. So here you can see it, the sum here only goes over the n samples of our signal, practically enough, right? We don't even need to care about this assumed periodic extension. So we just go over this one period of our signal, the length, And then we have the again this exponential here, e to the minus j, 2 pi, but now instead of having a omega n, so we have before, remember we had this e to the j omega, where was it? Here. So here we have e to the minus j omega n. This omega now looks more complicated or more easy. So now instead of omega we have this 2 pi divided by n times k. Right, and this shows us that this now becomes discrete valued. So k is a index, and this index goes from 0 to n minus 1, right? Just like our phase, basically. And basically, varying this index between 0 and n minus 1, we get frequencies between 0 and just below 2 pi. Right, so we have n frequency samples then. And that's also why instead of x of omega, we now have x of k, right? And again, k is this index between 0 and n minus 1. So it actually also makes it easier, because now instead of having infinitely many frequency values, we just have n frequency values, which makes it much more suitable for computing in our computer, because we only have finite amount of memory, right? So in this way we transform n samples, capital N samples, from our time signal in the time domain into the same number of samples in the frequency domain. So after that we have n samples xk. So really convenient. We have the same number of samples before and after, and also the same type. Well, except that the input can be real or complex valued, the output is always complex valued. The DFT output is always complex valued. Yeah, so observe, we can obtain the DFT from the DTFT as a special case, as I mentioned, if we take the finite length signal and make it periodic by repeating it infinitely many times into the future and the past, and then we apply the DTFT. And this gives us a discrete spectrum, since the signal is periodic. So the signal spectrum consists of the fundamental frequency coming from this period, which is the inverse of the length of x of n, and of its harmonics at multiple frequency of this fundamental frequency. And these are the coefficients of the output of the DTFT. Yeah, and in Python, you can obtain the DTFT with the function FFT. So you have the library scipy.fftpack. So FFTpack is a sublibrary of it. And in this sublibrary is the function FFT. And the FFT is for fast Fourier transform. And that's basically a fast implementation of the DFT. So that's also convenient. We have a fast implementation of the DFT. Good for slow computers. Yeah, so the properties here that we have is it is discrete in frequency because of the finite extent in time and periodic in time. Hence, the frequency index is now k and an integer number between 0 and n minus 1. And it is periodic in frequency with period n because it is discrete in time. So for k equals n, this corresponds to the normalized frequency 2 pi, which is our sampling frequency, right? And that's why we don't compute it, right? Because 2 pi then corresponds, because of this periodicity, to 0 again. Yeah, we also have an easy inverse transform. It almost looks the same as the forward transform, except that we have this 1 over n in the beginning, and then we have a plus instead of a minus sign of the exponent of e. Yeah, so that's also easy enough. And also we have a fast implementation, the function IFFT. So very convenient. Yeah, so since the DFT assumes that the signal assumes the signal to be periodic with period n, the convolution of the periodic signal called circular convolution becomes a multiplication in the DFT domain. So that's now a little bit tricky, right? Usually you don't do the circular convolution. So here you see it. We have two signals x and y in the time domain. Each is finite length, but now instead of just taking those sequences and zero pad them as you might want to do, we just repeat them infinitely many times and then do the convolution. And the result is this circular convolution here. So basically when we come to the end of x, we start over at the beginning, and the same for y. And if we do that, that corresponds to the multiplication of their two DFTs, right? And you can also write this circular convolution using the modulus function, as you can see here. So basically, this modulus function is doing this repeating at the beginning if you come to the end. So here, if this argument becomes larger than n, basically larger equal to n, then it starts at zero again. Yeah, so modulus function is the remainder after division by n. And it's between 0 and n minus 1. So if the argument here is between 0 and n minus 1, it stays the same. But if it then becomes n, then becomes 0 again, and so on. Yeah, so this corresponds to the Python NumPy function remainder, right? So NumPy has the function remainder, and this is doing the same thing. Yeah, so observe a finite or periodic signal in time leads to a discrete spectrum and a sampled time discrete signal leads to a periodic spectrum. Because of the symmetry between time and frequency, the same holds the other way around. So if we have a discrete frequency domain, we get a periodic time domain. If we had a periodic frequency domain, we have a discrete time domain. Okay. Yeah, and another important tool for us is the discrete cosine transform. So I mentioned the DFT gives us always complex valued results in the frequency domain. And it always gives us positive and negative frequencies. And we don't always want that. If we have real valued inputs, real valued samples, like usually our audio signals are, positive and negative frequencies are mirror symmetric. So basically the positive and the negative ones are just conjugate complex of the positive ones. So the negative ones don't give us any interesting information. So we can just drop it. And this is basically what the discrete cosine transform is doing. The discrete cosine transform gives us real valued frequency samples. So we don't need to worry about complex representations or complex numbers in programming. And it uses all the subbands on the positive side of the frequency, which means now we have twice as many subbands just on the positive frequency range alone, which means we get twice as high frequency resolution for it compared to the DFT. So two advantages at once. So we have real valued outputs. We don't need to worry about complex number types. And we have twice as much frequency resolution. So that's good. So here's the definition of the so-called DCT type 4, because there are several types. This is called type 4. And here you can see instead of e to the j something, which contains cosine and sine, j sine, now we only have the cosine here. Right? So basically, this is the real part of the e to the j something, right? So the cosine part. And we can see again, we have, instead of 2 pi over n, we now have pi over n. So that means we take the frequency range instead of minus pi to pi, or from 0 to 2 pi, which contains positive and negative frequencies. Now we just consider the positive frequency range from 0 to pi, and then divide it by n frequency subbands. So this is the bandwidth of each subband that we get. So we because we only have the positive frequencies, we don't need the 2 in front of it anymore. And here we can also see we add plus 0.5 to each, the time index and the frequency index, and this is basically particular to the type 4. So this gives it for audio, it gives it nice properties. But it doesn't have to be. There's actually also one where you don't have those plus 0.5, but then it doesn't work as well for audio. Yeah, so again, k is between 0 and n minus 1. And as I mentioned here, the shift of 0.5 is characteristic for the type 4. Yeah, and here this lowercase m is again our subband index at the lower sampling rate. So here you can see we subdivide our signal into blocks. So m basically is our block index. It jumps by n samples. And then for each block of n samples, we apply this DCT4. Right? So inside of each block, we perform this DCT4 and we get n frequency samples denoted by this index lowercase k. And that's done for each block m. So here you can see we again get a time frequency representation where m is the time index at the lower sampling rate and k is our frequency index. Yeah, and fortunately you can also get a function in Python which does the same thing. It's called DCT. And norm equals ortho means it has this factor square root of 2 over n. Right? It doesn't have to be there. If you don't have it for the DCT, we have the squared value for the inverse DCT. So on either side we will have it, and if we have it on both sides we have the benefit of energy conservation, which means the energy in the signal is the same as the energy in the subbands. Yeah, but unfortunately the FFT pack only has the DCT types 1 to 3 but not our favorite type 4. But the type 4 can be obtained using the type 3, using this function here which I show here. So basically this is the function DCT4 which I define here. So the input is the samples, so we have n samples coming in as argument. Here I'm using the FFT pack, importing the FFT pack, and first I'm upsampling my signal. So instead of taking the original, I upsample it by a factor of 2, and I do that because that gives me the chance to include this shift by 0.5, because a shift of 0.5 is a shift by 1 in the upsample domain. And this is what I'm exactly doing here. So first I'm initializing it and then I'm starting with sample number 1, which corresponds to the shift by 0.5 in the original sample domain. So here's my upsampled version with a shift of 0.5 or 1 in this new domain. Then I apply a DCT of type 3, type ortho, and since this capital N is now too large, I need to correct this factor here by square root of 2. And since I'm now getting 2n outputs because of this upsampled version, I'm just returning the first n coefficients, because the second n is basically the aliased version, which means the repeated version. So I'm just taking the first n ones from 0 to n minus 1. So this trick allows us to use the type 3 to obtain the type 4. Yeah, and then the inverse DCT4 transform looks like this. And it turns out it's exactly the same as the forward transform. So take a look at this and compare it to the previous one. It's identical, except here we have an X and for the inverse we have a Y. Right, so here you can see it. So now here we have the Y. But except for that, it's exactly the same. So here again is our block index. And our block index here also appears at the reconstructed signal. And you can see here we append each new block to the signal. So here we have n, mn plus the n now comes from the n of our DCT inverse transform. Right, so basically for each block we append the new inverse transformed to get a long signal. Yeah, so that's convenient because also we can use our trick for the forward transform. Basically we can apply the same function to the inverse. So in general the DCT4 inverse is identical to its forward transform, but up to a factor. And if this factor is 1, then it's an orthonormal transform, which we just did, right? We have this factor here, and this makes it an orthonormal transform. In Python, the Python function needs the argument norm equals ortho for this property. Right, so here in Python, we also have the IDCT. And for the type 3, they are not exactly the same, right? They're almost the same. But for the type 4, we have it exactly the same. So that's very convenient. Yeah. So this is what I just mentioned. The DCT provides twice the subband density compared to the DFT because we only consider the positive frequencies. So that